So now, what you all have been waiting for this evening, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker. It's a great pleasure to introduce Heather MacDonald. She is the Thomas W. Smith Fellow at the Manhattan Institute. Her books include The Diversity Delusion, How Race and Gender Pandering Corrupt the University and Undermine Our Culture, and also The War on Cops, which she wrote a few years ago, very timely today. Former U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions called Heather the greatest thinker on criminal justice in America today. Her writings have appeared in the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, New York Times, LA Times, and the New Republic. She's also a magnet for controversy. In 2017, students at Claremont McKenna College blocked her from addressing students and protested so disruptively that she required a police escort, and yet she never backs down. Heather earned degrees from Yale and Cambridge, and she also holds a JD from Stanford Law School. And on Monday, she has a new PragerU video coming out, which I know everyone will want to watch. Following her remarks, Heather will be interviewed by Jillian Melchior, whom you met earlier today, of course, editorial page writer with the Wall Street Journal, and one of our former Tony Blankley fellows. And now, without further ado, it is my great pleasure to welcome to the stage Heather MacDonald.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. This is an extraordinary pleasure. Earlier this week, the BBC Proms, London's beloved classical music festival, announced that the festivities this summer would no longer end with a group sing-along of Rule Britannia. Now, why would that be? Let me think. Oh, I know. It turns out that Rule Britannia is racist, sexist, classist, imperialistic, homophobic, Islamophobic, and you get the message. Now, if Nigel Farage were here this evening, as was originally planned, he would shred this assault on tradition, national pride, and the once glorious British Empire. Sadly, he is not here, thanks to our ongoing coronavirus hysteria. But his misfortune is my good fortune, since I am honored to participate in the great Steamboat Institute Annual Freedom Conference. Thank you. And in honor of Mr. Farage, I will try to imagine tonight what he might say about Britain's former colony and the even more radical attack on the very possibility of a civilized society that we have been experiencing over the last 6 months. Let's take a brief tour of our current moment. America is being torn apart by a lie that racism defines this country. The death of George Floyd under the knee of a Minneapolis police officer in late May 2020 catapulted this claim into national prominence. Riots and the desecration of national symbols followed. The violence began in Minneapolis and soon engulfed cities across the country, destroying thousands of livelihoods, turning city streets into war zones, and ripping apart the very foundation of law and order. Police officers were shot at, slashed, and assaulted with bricks and bottles. Their precinct houses and cruisers were firebombed. Courthouses were vandalized. Firefighters let private and public property burn to the ground rather than risk being attacked by the rioters. Professional thieves used stolen cars as missiles to hurtle into stores, which they then cleaned out through the shattered glass. The police held back, lest they be accused of racism. The flames of that terrible week have burned out, but the attack on civil order continues. Monuments to the nation's founders have been bulldozed and defaced in the name of fighting America's white supremacy. Anarchists colonized portions of Seattle and New York with impunity. In Portland, for weeks on end, Antifa thugs have hurled bombs at the federal courthouse. They have tried to burn law enforcement officers alive while those officers were trapped in buildings. Hundreds of criminals rampaged down the Magnificent Mile in Chicago this month in a frenzy of predation, attacking officers, smashing into businesses, and hauling away $60 million of merchandise in caravans. And now, Kenosha is the latest epicenter of this summer's unchecked savagery. And yet, I opened the New York Times this morning and learned that Republicans are making this anarchy up, if only. Police passivity in the face of this mass plunder has sent a clear message. Society no longer has the will to enforce law and order if doing so risks charges of racism. Not surprisingly, street crime has shot through the roof. Following the Floyd riots, homicides were up by 100% in Minneapolis, 200% in Seattle, 40% in St. Louis, 240% in Atlanta, and 182% in Chicago. In New York City, shootings have more than doubled. More than three dozen children have been fatally shot since the George Floyd riots, nearly all of them black. We seem to be returning to a feudal state of fortresses and moats. During this month's rioting in Chicago, Mayor Lori Lightfoot raised the bridges into downtown in the hope of preventing more vandal hordes from arriving across the Chicago River. Hot oil poured from ramparts may be next. Citizens are arming themselves at a record rate, having lost all confidence that government will protect them from civil and racial violence. Meanwhile, while actual physical safety has been destroyed in many places, our political leaders have embraced the anodyne mantra, "Stay safe," directed at a grossly overhyped threat. Has there ever been a more spirit-crushing, civilization-deflating exhortation than "Stay safe"? How about "Stay learned," "Stay curious," "Stay brave," "Stay enthralled by beauty"? The earth would never have been circumnavigated, the pilgrims would never have set out from England, the West would never have been won, if staying safe were the motto for human activity. Local and state governments are refusing to provide the security from violence that is their most fundamental obligation and which is the prerequisite for human striving and prosperity. Yet they are crushing economic activity in the name of keeping everyone safe from the coronavirus. The coronavirus lockdowns will prove the most consequential policy blunder in the nation's history, wiping out trillions of dollars of wealth overnight, decimating the hard work and dreams of millions of entrepreneurs, and constricting opportunity for generations to come. Those lockdowns, yes. And we're fighting them here. Those lockdowns are based on what now can only be regarded as a deliberate disregard of science. Since March, we have known that there is virtually no outdoor transmission, that the risk of death from the coronavirus is confined to a small and isolatable segment of the population, and that for everyone else, yes, this really does represent a severe case of the flu. Yet millions of Americans are still huddled at home, scared to death. When they dare to step outdoors into vast, windswept spaces, like here in Colorado, where there is no chance that their exposure to any possible viral droplets would last long enough or be concentrated enough to be infectious, they are self-righteously wearing masks and harassing those who know the science and who are not wearing masks. You've experienced it, believe me, what I've experienced in New York, you wouldn't, swearing, I'm glad I'm alive. The state has turned us into walking billboards of fear. Every mask donned in the open outdoors sends a message that lethal danger lurks everywhere. That is why we're told to wear masks outdoors, not because any so-called science requires it. Being afraid is now a badge of honor. A New York Times columnist wrote proudly of having canceled a restaurant reservation in newly reopened Missoula, Montana, where coronavirus deaths and cases were a nullity because he was so terrified of contracting the virus in the restaurant. A Los Angeles Times columnist chronicled his insane hygienic precautions on a road tour to Napa Valley this month. Think washing and quarantining every piece of loose pocket change after it had contacted a hotel room counter. The LA Times writer, Steve Lopez, told his story without the slightest hint of irony or shame. Are there no real men anymore? In this room, come on, be careful, save yourselves, because you're gonna have to breed very quickly. Now, where did these dual national impulses come from? The hot and murderous belief that America is defined by bigotry on the one hand, and the cowering submission to a cult of maximal risk aversion and fear on the other. Both are the products of the American University, which is why the Steamboat Institute's College Liberty Tours and Courage in Education Awards are so vitally important. From the moment an American college student begins his studies, he learns that he is either the oppressed or the oppressor. Freshman orientations feature workshops on white privilege and toxic masculinity. History, literature, and social science courses teach students to hate each other and to hate Western civilization. Mathematics is racist, rationality is racist, engineering is racist, the empirical method is racist. Even classical music is racist. A Columbia undergraduate groused about Columbia's beleaguered core curriculum. Quote, "Who is this Mozart, this Haydn, these superior white men?" The core, she said, quote, "upholds the premises of white supremacy and racism." Needless to say, Homer, Shakespeare, John Milton, William Wordsworth, and the founders are all felled by the same blade. Most preposterously, students in the favored victim groups believe that they are at risk of their lives from circumambient racism and sexism on a college campus. Of all places, the most tolerant environment in human history towards society's so-called marginalized groups. The commitment to the idea of America's constituent racism is the university's sole unifying ideology today. And that ideology has now taken root in America's mainstream institutions, whether in business, finance, big tech, or the arts. Denunciations of America's systemic racism poured from corporate boardrooms and C-suites over the summer, accompanied by an even more frenzied rush of donations to radical organizations that demonize the police and the country itself. That ideology of racial hatred is what burned our cities and what prevented law enforcement from quelling the violence. The coronavirus hysteria comes out of a more recent campus fetish, the cult of safetyism. You've all heard about safe spaces. Female and minority students apparently need protection from ideas that contravene campus orthodoxies. But the safetyism ethic has grown more sweeping, turning the entire campus into one big therapeutic safe space. College wellness programs offer essential oils, massage, yoga, mindfulness sessions, aroma diffusers, sandboxes, the inevitable therapy dogs, and encouragement to think of oneself as psychologically fragile and in need of therapy. What does this sound like? Well, I call it the college woke spa. Transplanted right out of Rodeo Drive and patronized by trophy wives, at least before Beverly Hills was also looted this June. The college woke spa represents the ongoing feminization of the university. Females now dominate the campus bureaucracy and many academic departments. They are pushing colleges ever further left and infusing them with an aversion to individualism, risk, and logic. The phrase, "I feel like," is replacing rational argument. And the culture at large is following in lockstep. The pajama boy of Obamacare fame was a harbinger of a feminized and infantilized woke male of today who flaunts his timidity and lack of manly initiative. So what can be done? Two things. First, we have to take on the myth of bias head on, as painful and uncomfortable as that is. As long as bias remains the only allowable explanation for ongoing racial disparities, the left wins and will continue dismantling our most precious institutions in the name of fighting systemic racism. Here is what we have to say. America is white supremacist? Are you kidding me? The opposite is the case. There is not a single mainstream institution today that is not trying to hire and promote as many underrepresented minorities as possible, and anybody who works in corporate America knows that for a fact. Every remotely selective college uses racial preferences in admissions. White privilege? No, here's the reality, black privilege. College high school students who are black will be admitted with scores with SATs and GPAs that would be automatically disqualifying if presented by white and Asian high school students. Well, what about policing? We're living through an epidemic of racially biased police shootings of black men, right? Wrong. Everything you think you know about policing from the media and the Democratic Party is wrong, wrong, wrong. A greater percentage of white and Hispanic homicide victims are killed by a cop than black homicide victims. Fully 10% of all whites and Hispanics who die of homicide are killed by a cop, compared to 3% of black homicide victims who are killed by a cop. So if we're going to have an anti-police lives matter movement, it would make more sense to call it white and Hispanic lives matter. Last year, there were 9 allegedly unarmed black males who were killed by the police. That's out of 7,300 blacks who died of homicide. That's 0.1% of all blacks who died of homicide who were killed by a cop, unarmed. Now I say unarmed allegedly because the phrase comes from the Washington Post database of police shootings. It defines unarmed extraordinarily generously to include people who have grabbed the officer's gun and are beating him with it or other pieces of police equipment. Blacks are actually shot less than their violent crime rates would predict. It is the rate at which officers encounter armed, violent, and resisting suspects that predict officer use of force, and sadly, that is disproportionately in inner city communities. White supremacists, please. Well-intentioned whites turn their eyes away in embarrassment from the senseless drive-by inner-city shootings that keep mowing down children in their beds and backyards. And the media and the activists don't give a damn, because those children are being killed not by the cops, not by whites, but by other blacks. Only the police pay attention, because they know that those criminals do not represent the thousands of good law-abiding residents in those communities who aspire to the same things that the rest of Americans do. LeBron James has been tweeting up a storm this summer to the effect that blacks are being hunted by whites virtually every time they step outside. The reality is this. If you look at all interracial black and white violence, so black on white and white on black, blacks commit over 85% of all interracial violence, whites less than 15%. This violence plays out in flash mobs, the knockout game, and wilding, all of which we must not speak of. What produced the Minneapolis riots? Not police brutality, but the social breakdown, such as the following. There was a string of robberies in Minneapolis last summer, 2019. In one, a group of a dozen youth kicked and beat a man while ripping off his pants and shoes and stealing the contents of his pockets. They then jumped on him like a trampoline, ran over him with a bike, and dropped planting pots on him. That same month, another man was beaten unconscious by a different group of youth robbers. If the victims had been black and their assailants white, this would have been an international scandal for weeks on end. But because the races were reversed, no one speaks of it. It is not racism that is producing any ongoing racial disparities in our economy, but behavior and culture, and above all, the breakdown of the family. And by excusing or ignoring that inner city cultural breakdown that produces exponentially higher rates of inner city victimization, America's elites are consigning those millions of good law-abiding, hard-working black citizens who yearn for more police protection and for stable neighborhoods to restricted liberty and opportunity, denying them the civil rights that they so heart-wrenchingly deserve. I have never been to a police community meeting in Harlem, in the South Side of Chicago, or South Central LA, where I have not heard the following. You arrest the dealers and they're back on the streets the next day. Why can't you keep them off the streets? We want more cops, not less. A cancer amputee, an elderly cancer amputee in the Mount Hope section of the Bronx said to me, "Please, Jesus, send more police." Because the only time she felt safe to go into her apartment lobby was when the police were there, because it was otherwise colonized by trespassing youth who were smoking weed and sending drugs. I hear from people like an elderly woman in the 41st precinct of the South Bronx who stood up during a police community meeting and, apropos of nothing, blurted out spontaneously, "How lovely when we see the police. They are my friends." These are the people that the media has their ears plugged to, who they never seem to find. Now, besides rebutting the myth of bias, we have to throw off the yoke of safetyism before it crushes us. I have all but given up on fighting safetyism with facts. They are out there. If anyone wants to find them, as Scott Atlas documented this morning, the facts about outdoor transmission, the facts about the median age of coronavirus decedents, 80, facts about the average number of coronavirus comorbidities, 3, facts about the vast survival rate, and facts about the lack of any causal connection between lockdowns and case counts and mortality rates. Nobody wants to listen. The public apparently prefers that vicarious thrill of fear, and politicians and public safety, public health experts prefer that unparalleled erotic rush of power. So this economic catastrophe must be fought at the level of fundamental civilizational principles. I yearn for a politician who will get up and say, "Yes, there will be more deaths. Get over it." There are deaths from everything. Death is the banal end of life. A mature civilization understands that life is about balancing risks and costs. If saving just one life, as New York Governor Cuomo said, is worth every single public policy, the speed limit would be set universally on every road at 25. Because we are happy to put up with at least 40,000 highway deaths a year, knowing that those deaths will happen because we value our convenience in getting places faster more. We would end the construction of bridges. We would end the construction of mines, because it is a statuarial truth that every big construction project will entail some loss of life, but we balance the risks, the benefits, and the costs. We must go on. We must conquer fear. We cannot go shutting down all economic life, which is the very staff of life, to avoid one particular kind of risk for one particular kind of death. We will protect our vulnerable population with love and compassion. We will care for them, but we will resume our normal lives. Bring back opera and orchestras. Bring back beauty. America cannot go on living in fear. We are destroying our children, both psychologically and educationally. Open up your houses. Let your children play with each other. Open up your schools. Finally, of course, we need to vote before that right to gets canceled by the PC police. We no longer merely stand on a precipice. We are falling down into it, into an abyss of violence. We seem to be heading towards civil war. We must reestablish the norms of law and order and the courage to face risk and transcend it. And for those twin tasks, the Steamboat Institute, with its commitment to the glory and beauty of entrepreneurship, of risk-taking, of empire-building, of free and open competition and market exchange, is uniquely positioned to lead the way. Whether we want to sing Rule Britannia or God Bless America, take off your masks, banish the phrase stay safe from your lexicon, fill your lungs with fresh air, and let freedom ring. Thank you.
I think, can we grab that mic?
Yes.
Great. Here you go. No problem. So I've got to say, this is a surprise to me. I had always anticipated that when I came and saw you speak, that it would be on a college campus and that you'd be being booed rather than cheered. So this is quite refreshing.
Yes, it's to have an actual live audience and not having people walk out. It is truly a novel experience.
So. I want to start by having you describe what happened to you at Claremont McKenna College. And why I ask this is that for me was a tipping point. It was an understanding that things at college campuses had happened in a way that civil discourse was possibly impossible. And you warned me at the time that this is something that had spread to broader culture. So can you describe what happened and also draw the line from that moment to now?
Well, I'd been invited by a government institute at Claremont McKenna. Claremont McKenna is a small liberal arts college in Southern California. It used to be viewed as a bastion of conservatism. The Claremont Institute came out of it. Leo Strauss, even a strong tradition of reading the founders. And they had some of the faculty there, to its enormous credit, had invited me to talk about The War on Cops, my book on policing. A few days before I was scheduled to speak, they picked up on Facebook that there was a heck of a lot of organizing going on against me. A call went out on Facebook to shut down the racist, classist, homophobic, anti-blah, blah, blah, Heather McDonald. We will not allow a fascist to speak on our campus. So I got initially I got a notice from the sponsors saying, well, we're moving the venue from the original planned one, which had too much plate glass, in order to protect your safety. I thought, that doesn't sound so great. So I had to be brought onto campus. Basically, it was daylight, but it was basically under the cloak of secrecy and deception, put in a safe house, essentially, where I could hear the drumming and the chanting rising in decibel level outside. I couldn't see them, but I could hear it, and I felt something like the Eugene O'Neill's Emperor Jones, you know, with the blood boiling up. I was escorted down a secret passageway through a kitchen into the auditorium where I was supposed to speak. I was supposed to have had dinner with about 300 selected undergraduates, but what had happened was is that the protesters had circled the auditorium so that nobody could get in. There was a, on video, you can see an elderly biology professor trying to get in. The students are physically pressing him back. And of course, they engaged in the usual maudlin histrionics where the black students, and they came from the seven related undergraduate colleges in that area, Pomona, Scripps, Pfitzer, Harvey Mudd. The black students were in the inner ring and the white students were outside because the myth was is that the black students would be just pummeled to a pulp by the campus police, which of course is preposterous. The campus police basically lay down, rolled over, and started mewing like a little kitten and let this mob take over the university. So I spoke to an empty room at a podium. The event was live streamed, and they took a few questions that were live streamed in. After two of them, the police who had been in the room with me decided that they could no longer guarantee my safety because the plate glass windows that were out there, people were bashing them so hard and I could hear this. And so they thought that they couldn't allow me to stay in. So I was hustled out the kitchen, out a back door and into a police van and was taken to the Claremont Police Department and went back home to Irvine. But this was obviously one of many. I mean, I'm hardly the only campus speaker to have experienced this, and Charlie Kirk has been through much, much worse. Ben Shapiro has. But the mentality that students are entitled to try and silence voices that they disagree with now is pretty much universal. And it is not countered by the administration. It is not countered by the faculty. We're developing this whole conceit that hate speech is a form of violence and therefore can be censored. And of course, what constitutes hate speech is ever expanding like an oil slick. It takes in the most innocuous statements. So it's only gotten worse. I confess that I'm a pessimist by nature. It's a sort of a constituent part of me. I didn't think it was going to get better, and it's going to take a heck of a lot of effort. Charlie Kirk is absolutely right. Don't send them another damn cent. You've got Americans are generous to a quite dangerous fault. You believe. I can just tell you, your college is not what you think it was. It's not the college you graduated from. We want to give. We have this extraordinary tradition of private philanthropy. No other country has it. But you've got to find other. There's many, many deserving outlets of your generosity, not any college that is not 100% certified to be free of the poison of identity politics.
So we have now a situation on college campuses where there's been a willful abandonment of reason, a willful abandonment of Enlightenment ideals, a idea that if science contradicts your feelings and emotions and lived experience, then the science is what has to go and what has to change, not your mind. How did we get there? How did the entire tradition that has moved human progress, what dealt it such a blow that it could deteriorate so quickly?
Well, I think it's a combination of the identity politics of the race and, again, sorry, I know you all have really great daughters and they're all going to win the Nobel Prize in math, but there really is a feminization of the university going on. On average, and this is what got James Damore fired from Google in August of 2018, he wrote a 10-page fact-based memo saying that the reason that Google and other big firms are not 50-50 male and female is probably not due to Google's discrimination against females. It's the same thing with minorities. Every big tech firm is trying to hire as many females as it can, but they're not in the pipeline to the same extent. Why? Because on average, and Damore was talking to a group of engineers, you would think they would understand about distribution curves. On average, Your average male is more attracted to abstract, ideas-based work, and females, on average, are more attracted to human-centered, hands-on relational work. And again, I'm not speaking about your daughters and granddaughters. They're on their way to their physics Nobel Prize. I know that. I'm talking about the females who are not at Google. But that got James Damore fired. Why? Because Google's CEO, who was just up there testifying on Congress last month, imported the language of academic feminist victimology. He said Google's 10-page memo made Google's females feel unsafe at work. Oh, those poor females. I cringe. I really do. If you don't believe that's the case, and another thing, psychology has known for decades, it has what's called the big five personality traits. One of them is called, and this is what it's been called for decades, neuroticism. Poor James Damore, the innocent, the little lamb, was so naive as he thought he could use the word neuroticism, which is, again, it's a psychological term of art, to explain the different distributions of career preferences and predilections, and he said that females score higher on neuroticism, which has been a known psychological truth for decades. That, as you can imagine, produced a widespread cultural meltdown, because you're not allowed to say that females are more risk-averse and more prone to anxiety, but they are. So that has been pushing. So now, of course, in law schools, the Socratic method, whereby professors do cold calling on students to discuss the case, the legal case that they were supposed to have read overnight, and engage them in a fairly aggressive colloquy, the Socratic method is all but jettisoned in law schools because it's seen as anti-female. So how are these law students going to handle being in front of a judge? Well, the answer is we're also changing the law. And we saw this in the terrifying Believe Survivors moment, the Brett Kavanaugh hearings that Molly Hemingway has written so profoundly about. The idea that females are entitled to automatic credence if they claim they're a victim of sexual assault, that is a violation of our most profound legacy of the presumption of innocence. And yet, the Yale and Harvard law schools were convulsed by Believe Survivors protests during Brett Kavanaugh's hearings. A large, disproportionate percentage of Yale and law school graduates are going to go to the federal bench. If they carry the Believe Survivors mantra with them, the human civilization-long yearning for impartiality under the law, for being judged by laws and not by men, not by hot partisan passions, it's over, because the decks are stacked against you. And you males, it's over for you, unless we can get the civilization back.
So on getting the civilization back, I note that James Damore is no longer at Google, and I'm watching the indoctrination that's happened at college campuses make their way to the workplace. Robin DiAngelo's White Fragility is now a bestseller, in part because employers are requiring their employees to read this. But it strikes me that there are perverse incentives here, that the safest and most rational choice for you in a workplace is not to challenge this dogma, to stay quiet. You reap enormous social benefits. You can consider yourself a person who is concerned with justice, who is concerned with equality. Whereas if you speak out, you put on the line your job, your reputation. You may be canceled, you may be ruined, you may be considered undateable, you may be shamed, you may be targeted, you may be the victim of violence. So how do we change those incentives?
Do not be afraid. You've got to speak the truth. Speak it to your friends, speak it to your children. You cannot be cowed by the charge of racism or sexism. We have got to fight lies with truth. And I would also add, And obviously Charlie Kirk described this conveyor belt out of the university into corporations. He's absolutely right. During the James Damore hysteria, there was a Google chat room, an internal email chat room that got publicized. And one comment said, "We've got to shut down this diversity nonsense before it destroys Google." They don't call it HR. Google has little fancy googly names for every traditional corporate function. So instead of an HR department, Google has people analytics. Well, our people analytics department is basically an outpost of women's and black studies. So the people are coming out of the universities. They're taking over the HR departments. They're taking over the CEO departments. And I would also add, Jillian, you were asking about the sciences. The optimists among us have long held that, of course, STEM, the STEM field, science, technology, engineering, and math, are by definition invulnerable to this. Nobody would possibly think of subjecting the STEM fields to race and gender quotas, right? Again, wrong. It has already been happening. The pressure on every large science field firm and the science departments to hire, promote, and admit females and underrepresented minorities is huge. When it comes to race, the skills gap is massive. Medical schools, again, admit black medical students that are over a standard deviation below in MCAT scores. They pass them on. They get put into residency. They fail the medical licensing exam at astronomical rates. It doesn't matter. The same thing happens in law school. But it's the sciences that we should really worry about. And sadly, Trump has done a great job, as we've heard today, with deregulation, but he has not reamed out the awful, poisonous ideology in our national science grant-making foundations. The National Science Foundation, which was founded in 1956 by Congress to be the nation's premier funder of basic science research, its motto now, it believes that the only good science is diverse science. It has been doling out tens, if not hundreds of millions of your taxpayer dollars studying alleged heteronormativity in engineering and mathematics, studying microaggressions, pressuring engineering and physics departments to hire not on the basis of scientific knowledge, but on the basis of the trivialities of your gonads and melanin. And so we are losing our scientific competitive edge. I've said, if Trump really wants to close the gap with China, here's what he should do. He should airlift a couple of airplane cargo holds filled of gender feminists and dump them on Beijing University.
So I hear your point about how courage inspires courage, how we have a responsibility to speak out even if it's uncomfortable. But also, when I'm looking at the current generation in college, I note that amid the pandemic, CDC has found that within the last month, one in four of them has seriously considered suicide. I'm looking at these protests and the narrative that they say about the United States, the narrative that they say about our founding principles and our opportunity, our ability for upward mobility. And I guess I'm also looking at that we have a crisis where perhaps this is a bit opportune, that what it takes to be a courageous young person, a heroic young person, is for you to spend months hunkered down in your house, engaged in self-care. And I guess I'm wondering if we have a generation that has been so coddled to the point where they are terrified, how do you turn that around? How do you teach the next generation courage?
I don't know. I'm going to confess something, and I hope I don't offend the sorority and fraternity brothers and sisters out here. I don't feel an innate connection. I didn't have fraternity and sorority in college. But I have to say, they're our last best hope. You know, I love it when I read about the fraternity parties, and they're not wearing masks. So there seems to be a split in the college-going population. we heard this morning about the in China with the young turning on their parents. At the very start of this, I gave a speech at Washington and Lee University that was less protested than most. In fact, it went pretty okay because of the selection of the audience. But it was the last day before Washington and Lee shut down. A couple days later, a woman who was there told me that her daughter had called the family doctor on her parents because they had held a family prayer service at their home that had 10 participants, including the parents, rather than the mandated 9. So you have on the one hand the let's party fraternity culture, and then you do have the enforcers, the people that already absorbed the college woke spa ideology and are going a step further with this. So it's kind of a race against time. I believe in respecting authority and tradition. I have obviously deplored the 1960s student protests. I hate the idea. I remember in the 80s and 90s, the New York Times and the Washington Post used to periodically write this story, where have all the student protests gone? As if you can't be a college student unless you're, you know, blowing off your chemistry exam in order to protest. My view is, thank God the protests have disappeared, which they really hadn't. But now I'm kind of thinking, where are the student protesters? Why are you guys taking this so passively? What happened to adolescent rebellion against these timid, constraining adults? It's a complicated scene right now in the universities because the universities have been exposed for the greedy capitalist pigs that they've been all along because they're desperate for those tuition dollars. They have entire industries within universities called enrollment management, and they speak the language of yield curves and marketing strategies to try and rustle up as many live bodies from the bushes as they can to fill the empty seats, because there's so many, there's probably 10 times more students going to college right now than should be. We could cut the college-going population by 9/10. We would possibly save higher education for what it's supposed to be, which is the pursuit of things of difficult cognitive difficulty and civilization, and allow people to enjoy, as Charlie Kirk said, the joys of mastering things, of figuring out how machines work. This is noble. It is beautiful to work with your hands. With this idea that everybody should go to college is absurd, and it kills me when good-meaning Republican donors in Manhattan, all of whom have social uplift programs in Harlem, they inevitably use as their metric of success for their social uplift programs the college-going rate. And I think, no, we've got to stop this. So I don't know. It's as I say, a part of me hopes for a little bit more spirit of knee-jerk rebellion on the part of students, because right now, far too many of them, and I also say, where are the Tea Partiers? Far too many Americans have taken this lying down. It's we've learned something about the American people that is somewhat disturbing, and again, that's why the Steamboat Institute, with its fearless commitment to moving forward, to overcoming risk, is so essential.
So I'm going to open this up shortly for questions. You've got a QR code, I'll get it up here. But I've got two more questions for you before we do this. So I've spent a lot of the last couple of years reading the social justice literature, immersing myself in intersectional thought. It's been the equivalent of a really useful gender and racial studies degree.
Or self-flagellation.
Yes. But one of the things that struck out to me is there is a fair critique that the United States, in the Declaration of Independence, had these ideals. We didn't live up to them. This is what Frederick Douglass was getting at in his 4th of July speech. This is what Martin Luther King Jr. was speaking about in a letter from a Birmingham jail. So we have this history of racism that contradicts America's founding principles. We have young people that see disparities in race and gender and are rightly concerned about them. But if the answer to it is not what we're doing right now, And if the answer to it isn't, I mean, if you ask where students are protesting, they're protesting in Chicago, they're protesting in Seattle, they're protesting in Portland, they're protesting on the streets of Kenosha. But this protest has been violent. It's been counterproductive. It doesn't serve violence, and it ultimately holds us back and commits new injustices. So if what's coming out of the universities isn't the action, isn't the answer to this, if affirmative action isn't the answer and if rioting isn't the answer, what is?
Well, it is a truism. It is unthinkable how America could stay blind for so many centuries and decades to the fundamental contradiction between its founding ideals and its treatment of blacks. And, you know, one looks back at those courageous, inspiring, not just public figures like Ella Fitzgerald or Nat King Cole, who triumphed over the most excruciating hatred to participate in creating America's civilization in its music, in its theater, in its culture, but also the good, hardworking people that were not famous, who lived in Chicago's Bronzeville, who created societies for insurance, who went to church, who kept striving. It breaks one's heart to see what they overcame and the fact that they preserved their belief in America when we at the present cannot do so. And if you came from Mars, it would in fact seem incomprehensible and absolutely impossible that we could go from so ingrained a blindness to our racial hypocrisy to what I would say, I'm sorry, it truly is the opposite. It is simply not the case that there is systemic racism. There is no institution, I cannot stress this enough, there is no mainstream institution in this country that is discriminating against blacks. The opposite is the case. Is there some gas station? I don't want to besmirch any southern state. I don't. So I'm not even going to pull one out of the hat because it's not for me to make that judgment. Let us look at the behavior of white Republicans. They have had one love affair after another with black politicians, whether it's Ben Carson, Alan Keyes, Alan West, Colin Powell. What matters is not race, but values. Do you share the bourgeois values that are essential to civilization, the values of hard work, deferred gratification, self-discipline, and the notion that every male has an indefeasible obligation to care for and raise his children in conjunction with the mother of those children? When the marriage norm breaks down, as it has in the inner city, where you have nationally about 71% of black children are born out of wedlock, and in places like Milwaukee, West Baltimore, it's closer to 85 to 90%. That is a civilizational catastrophe that I certainly lack the eloquence to describe, because it means that males, young boys, grow up without the expectation that they will be responsible for the children that they father. It's not just that they are raised without fathers, it's they're raised without the expectation of the most profound and basic responsibility, without which nothing else matters, which is you're responsible for your children. Instead, we have what's known in the social science literature as multi-partner fertility. So in inner city areas, any given mother has children by several different males. Any given male has children by several different mothers. It is chaos. So I would say I've come to the conclusion that the big difference between liberals and conservatives and progressives and conservatives is that progressives see structural explanations for disparities. And so they will say to conservatives, you're blind. How can you not see the facts? You say we're blind to facts. You're blind to the facts that there are obvious differences in opportunity. There is no question that being raised in Pacific Palisades or Greenwich, Connecticut, you start out with a leg up to somebody who's being brought up in Harlem. And they would say that those structural explanations lie behind everything else. And the conservative will say, okay, yes, systemic, but they're more likely to point to personal responsibility and individual choices. Yes, there are differences in starting advantages, but William Galston, an advisor to Bill Clinton, said something in the 90s, and it has never been disproven. He talked about what's known as the success ethic or success recipe. To be middle class, to escape poverty, you only have to do three things. Graduate from high school, notice, not college, work full time at a job, any job, low wage, minimum wage, doesn't matter, and defer child rearing until you're married. You do those three things, and about 70% of people, 75% people who follow that, are not poor. So you may be poor, but you don't have to have children out of wedlock. You may be poor, but you should monitor your children's homework, make sure that he's taking his textbook home, counter the pernicious ethic that to try in school is to act white. This has stunted, that ethic has stunted so many black children's lives. So the systemic racism, they see that, and also let's not pretend that these young people who are out there raising hell and drunk on the power of destruction, because we have unleashed something that the founders understood, which is that the veneer of civilization is thin. Underneath that veneer is animal hatred and lust. And when you discredit the institutions of criminal justice and of law, you are allowing the furies out. The furies that Aeschylus understood when he wrote the Oresteia, that will bring civilization down. Those kids are out there not because they care about justice, but because they're having a damn good time. And let's not give them credit for being somehow virtuous, because this thing is now a social contagion. So I would say again, how do you counter the narrative of systemic racism that's holding everybody back? All I can say is point to the demonstrable facts of racial preferences in every institution. Point to the fact that Americans are good people. The Obamas, there was Michelle Obama echoing Biden's acceptance speech, saying, oh, Americans are great, but they've never wiped the stain of systemic racism from their national character. How can they be great if they are still stained by racism? And there was Michelle Obama talking about the stain of systemic racism, repeating the lie that Barack Obama said during the memorial service for 5 Dallas police officers who were assassinated in July of 2016 by an assassin who was inspired by the Black Lives Matter movement. Obama went to that memorial service and repeated the lie that black parents are right to fear that their child will be killed by a cop every time they step out into the street. Michelle Obama repeated that. Joe Biden has repeated that. The Obamas got a book deal from Penguin Random House for $65 million because Americans so loved the Obamas that they knew that these books would fly off the shelves. I'm sorry, we are not systemically racist. We care about character and who you are and what you have done as a person.
Thank you. So, for the last question, I've received several questions about policing and on the current protest movement, and I'm going to try to combine them to hit the main themes that I think you guys have asked. So a couple of things. First of all, we see videos like the George Floyd video. We see videos that are disturbing, like what happened in Kenosha. Are there reforms that you see within the police force is worth doing to weed out those individual bad actors or potential bad actors? Second, the left's argument on systemic racism is that you don't have to be an individual racist doing bad things. Participation in a system that is oppressive is enough. So are police unions an example of systemic racism in that they protect the worst of the worst? And third, if the answer, I've gotten several questions about defund the police, the consequences of that, and what the alternative is.
Well, we've got to do everything we can to make sure that police have the tactical training to avoid at all costs their being believing that they're in a position where they have no alternative but to use lethal force. Officers are desperate for more hands-on, realistic tactical training. This is putting them through realistic scenarios, whether video. The New York Police Department, which is very well funded, has an entire village that it's constructed, that they'll have like an active shooter situation where the police have to go through city alleyways and learn how to take cover to make sure that you're not in a situation where you're exposed, where you don't have backup, and you feel like you can only use force. I know officers in Chicago who pay for their own tactical training because they're not getting enough of it. I've advocated de-escalation training. It's a good thing to learn how to talk situations down. Unfortunately, there was some studies that came out this summer that showed that de-escalation training doesn't do much. Not many programs do. I'll tell you what they don't need is implicit bias training, which is what Joe Biden is going to offer forth at taxpayer expense. I attended an implicit bias training by the premier purveyors of such, Lori Friedle's outfit, in Chesterfield, Missouri, a few miles away from Ferguson. It was an insult. It was ridiculous. It's a waste of time, the officer's time, and it's a waste of taxpayer money. Now, we have seen these videos. You and we are the victim of selective coverage. I remember in 2016, the head of the Congressional Black Caucus, late in summer, stood up and said, well, as we all know, the vast majority of victims of fatal police shootings this year have been black. Well, he was incredibly wrong, but in one sense, one can't blame him, because the media only covers police shootings of black men. In fact, at that point, when he said this, as is true every year, whites were over 50% of all victims of fatal police shootings, and blacks about 25%. It varies from year to year, 23, 26%. We see the individual cases. We know George Floyd. Who knows Tony Timpa? Tony Timpa was an absolute, almost cookie-cutter adumbration of George Floyd. In 2016, the 32-year-old schizophrenic called the cops in Dallas saying, I'm off my meds, I'm scared, and I need help. The cops responded. He'd already been handcuffed by store security guards. They put him on his stomach. He was not resisting arrest. He offered no resistance. And the officers kept him pinned down with their knee for 13 minutes. 30 times during that time he said, you're killing me. They joked about his mental condition during that time. Finally, an ambulance arrived. The cops put him in the ambulance, and one of the cops said, I hope we haven't killed him. Well, he was already dead, combined cocaine overdose and the pressure, just as we're now learning that George Floyd likely died from the fentanyl overdose that was filling his lungs with foam, which is why he couldn't breathe. So had Tony Timpa been black, it would have been a George Floyd incident. It would have been an international scandal for months on end. He was white, so you've never heard of him. I'm not going to take the time now. I could go through name after name of white victims. Am I justifying Tony Timpa? Am I justifying George Floyd? No. The cops kill 1,000 people each year. That has been constant for the last 5 years that we've had our most stable records. 1,000. Nobody has ever said if that's too high or too low. Obviously, it would be great if the cops shot nobody. The cops they make at least 50 million arrests a year. For every 10 lethal weapons assaults on an officer, the cops kill one person. Is that too many? I don't know. I keep waiting for Black Lives Matter to tell me, what is the proper ratio? As Charlie Kirk said today, a police officer is between 18 and 30 times more likely to be killed by a black male than an unarmed black male is to be killed by a cop. So, yes, let's give the cops more training. They need training above all in courtesy and respect. They too often develop hardened, calloused attitudes towards the public, in part because, especially these days, when they get out of their cop car, they're surrounded by hostile, jeering crowds, throwing things at them, airmail. If you have a family member in law enforcement, he works in an East Coast city, he knows about airmail. Airmail is things like bags of feces and urine that are thrown at cops from the roofs of public housing. As far as the police unions being emblematic of systemic racism, I've not heard that argument. Possibly. There are some unions who are very powerful, others less so. And I have had chiefs whom I respect a lot say that some unions do make it very difficult to get rid of the recurrent bad cop. On the other hand, let me just say this. Just because in a shooting situation, the press uncovers that any given officer has had a history of civilian complaints against him, that may represent a bad cop. It may also represent an active cop. Most cops are lazy. They're happy to go into passive, responsive mode, which is what's happening now, which is why crime rates are spiraling through the roof, because cops are just driving by scenes of disorder. A small percentage of cops are the ones who actually do the work to get the guns off the street, who get out of their cars at 2 a.m. and make that stop of a known drug dealer hanging out on a corner, a known drug corner at 2 a.m., hitching up his waistband as if he has a gun. They don't have to make that stop. It's a lot easier to drive on by and wait for the next shots fired call or robbery call to come over the radio and respond after the fact. That's not how you save lives. The cops who are active routinely have complaints filed against them by drug dealers to try and slow them down. So It's until you know more, the fact that somebody has a history of complaints doesn't tell you much. So yes, we should make sure that unions are not blocking reasonable discipline, but there's a part of me, and you know, I'll tell you, sometimes cops are a pain in the butt. They're a bunch of grousers. They whine. I've never come across a commissioner who the cops sort of like. You know, but they feel that the world is against them. And part of me, as dysfunctional as it can be, I get their sense of solidarity. And the amazing thing is, some of my most optimistic moments racially are visiting precinct houses. Because those houses are the post-racial America. Most black cops feel the same way as white cops. They think the whole racial profiling conceit is ludicrous. They understand that policing today is not driven by race, it's driven by victimization. They know why they're in minority neighborhoods. It's not to oppress blacks, it's to free the law-abiding from fear. And they know that the driving while black conceit is wrong. So I have seen, you know, it's sort of the heavenly city in a sense in precinct, but they feel like they are a hunkered down minority that nobody understands. And that's a bad mindset. It can lead to an us against them mentality, which can get too extreme. But I can't be too hard on the cops because things are really bad for them. They've been that way for decades, but they've gotten a lot worse over the last 5 years.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Heather McDonald.